In the studio is our old friend, haven't seen him in a while, Mark Formby. Good morning, sir. Chairman of the Mississippi Workers' Commission. How are you?
I'm doing well. Good morning.
You
staying
busy?
I brought my pollen throat today. I'm like everybody else now. I've got that.
God,
I don't know if that makes it a better radio voice or a worse radio voice.
I don't know. I have no idea. I've got some issues with the throat anywhere, so it doesn't help out this time of the year. But
that's right.
You think sooner or later with all the rain we've had, it would wash it out.
You think, it rains the pollen out and then the pneumonia sneaks in.
Is that what happens?
No, it's the rain, you know.
Did you come down with COVID? Did you get by?
No, sir. I was blessed. I don't recall that it even got close to me. I mean, yeah. Obviously, you know, in the peripherals it did. Facebook always says, do you know somebody that had it? Do you know somebody that passed? And I know both very well.
Yeah.
We had close friends in our church.
Mark, where are your offices?
Lakeland.
It's on Lakeland.
It's on Lakeland. If you head out Lakeland, about the first hill next to the fire station, right behind there.
All your people back or some work from home?
We have everybody back except for a couple who are working from home because of other issues.
Yeah. If it's one of those agencies, if you wanted to go into the missing persons report, just go be chairman of the Mississippi Workers.
That's just not right. But it's kind of true, and that's probably the way it should be. I mean, this is a regulatory job. It's not a legislative job. It's an administrative job in-house.
Yeah.
But it's a judicial sort of position. So that's right.
Telling Judge, our good friend Virginia Carlton, and I said, because she was on the air with me all the time in the legislature.
She vanished into court.
Yeah, we'll never see you again.
That's true. So maybe I'll be back. You never know.
Well, you're invited back anytime. For people who don't know exactly what you do in the Workers' Compensation Commission is, but a little mission statement, I'm sure you can do a better job than I can.
Well,
on this.
And I can do it briefly. You know, when you get injured at work, your company has workers' comp, or they should if they're within the law, and they do what they're supposed to do, and they get you treatment, and they get you back to work. When they don't, then we get involved. If a case is controverted, then it comes through the workers' comp. They're all reported to us, and we do that for statistical information, if nothing else. But ultimately, it comes through the workers' comp process. We have judges. You go to a workers' comp judge. You can do that with an attorney or without an attorney. And if it is appealed from our judges, then the commission, which is a three-panel commission, myself and Commissioner Henry and Commissioner Harkins, and we hear the case. If you are not happy with our decision, you go to the Supreme Court.
So
it's the process of making sure you get your benefits correctly.
Yeah. You hear those cases on a regular basis or as they come up?
We hear every Monday is set aside for for oral arguments, actually in a courtroom where we sit. And then on the rest of the week, we do settlements prior to COVID, we did them in person in the office.
Yeah.
But now we do them by telephone or without anybody present.
Since you've been there, now you've been there for what, four years
in April.
What's the rejection rate?
The rejection rate on
who is turned down for workman's comp?
Well, we have about 11,000 injured workers a year that actually file for workers' comp. Obviously, you know, if you cut yourself on paper and you put a Band-Aid on it, that you go on. But if it's a reportable case, we have about 11,000 a year. About 2,000 of those are controverted, which means
contested.
Yep. And so of those, probably half are eventually then settled.
Yeah.
We do about 125 in-court type cases a year, and then obviously have to sign off on the other 2,000.
How long can you stay on a workman's comp?
Well, I've been praying about that. It's a 6-year appointment. How long can a person stay?
Yeah,
how long can a person? Well, that's the question I've been asked. You know, I'm 4 years into this, and you'd be amazed the number of people, some of whom are like vultures sitting on a limb. You know, they're going,
Do you really actually want to stay on workman's comp for 12 years?
Well, the reality is you can stay on workers' comp, you know, for the medical part forever. Benefits are done by a formula, so eventually you play out of your compensation benefits. But if you have a lifetime injury, you can be on medication benefits.
So that employer is going to be responsible for that.
Insurance company will be responsible for it until your death. Mm. Now, but that's what the settlements do. A lot of time they will come in and they will do a medical set aside based on statistical information that says this is based on your life and your projected lifetime, your total benefits would equal $250,000. Yep. And so then they'll settle that. So you actually are off of workers' comp, but you have still been compensated for life.
Somebody gets injured, let's say in 15 minutes from now, and to throw no fault of their own, something that should not have been at a company or office or wherever it happens to be, what's the first thing that they should do?
Go to their in-house HR person or their manager, their immediate supervisor.
Immediately.
Obviously, you know, if you're hurt bad.
You want a paper trail.
Well, if you're it's just you've got to start the process, yeah. Because it removes you from your regular insurance onto workers' comp benefits. So obviously, if you go out in an ambulance, if it's that kind of situation, then it's different. But most of the injuries, matter of fact, a lot of injuries are not reported for a couple of days because you pull a muscle, you think you're going to go home and be fine. The next day it's worse, and about by the third day you're calling in saying, I can't come to work, I hurt myself Monday or whatever. So so you just report it.
Yeah. How fast do those the checks come in?
I think that varies by carrier, but it's a good it's a good system. It really is. And I deal with all aspects of it. I deal with the claimants and the attorneys on both sides and the carriers and the employers, and really and truly most everybody is trying to do the right thing. Even when somebody is turned down, it's because the employers usually legitimately think that they weren't hurt on the job, that they brought it to the job, or that they're overemphasizing their symptoms. I think most everybody is trying to do the right thing.
That's where I want to talk to you also about medical marijuana when we come back in the next break, but do you have an investigative? You got investigators, full-time investigators here?
No, I don't, because I don't have a budget that would let me do that. That was one of the things.
Do you need one or two?
I would like to have somebody that would do that. I mean, the way workers' comp works is we assess the companies that do business in the state for our budget, and the legislature has to approve it. If we have companies who are out there who are not paying into that pool, then obviously that it's just like any other insurance or taxes. Yeah. It drives it up for everybody else. So I would like to do that. Now, what actually happens is that on casework, as far as trying to find out if an employee is really injured or not, insurance companies kind of do that. They actually have people that they pay.
So if there are some rumors out there that the guy is, on the beach swimming.
I've seen videos. It's not just rumors. I have seen videos. One of somebody dancing on the tabletop at a popular bar in the panhandle of Florida. So
I'm going through the stories because I had a story in the stack yesterday, and I'm not sure if I still kept it, but it was when you hear these stories, the guy's back is hurt, but they film him at the doing the workout.
Yeah, well, I saw this video. This was a person who was literally dancing on a table at a popular bar down there. And it's just kind of, you could say, well, I felt so good at that moment. But,
that's going to be a hard sell, though, isn't it?
Well, it reminds me of my legislative days when people were trying to get on disability and you'd go to their house because you wanted to be helpful. Yep. You wanted to make sure that you were helpful. And you'd have to sit in the car and wait for them to get out of the butterbean patch. And you think, if you can pick butterbeans, that's hard to argue a really bad back.
You better believe it because, it depends on how many you pick, too.
Well, I guess that. And how bad the back, I'll be fair.
So bring all those to court and let's see exactly. We're counting butterbeans, baby. You bring them to the courtroom. You miss the legislature?
I miss the people in the legislature. I miss about September. I have ideas like everybody else, and now like everybody else, I don't get the opportunity to file those ideas as legislation. I am fortunate that I have friends still in the legislature, and if I have an idea that they think is worthy, they will still do that. But I don't miss a lot of the minutiae of the legislature, but I do miss the people.
Let me go back to the question that you answered that I didn't ask. You're thinking about another term?
Oh,
when are you going to make a decision?
Let me say this. It's a six-year term. The statute sort of suggests continuity in the chairmanship by reappointing. So obviously I'm thinking about what I plan to do next at my age, and that would obviously...
But you'd have to be reappointed by the governor?
I'd have to be reappointed by the governor.
Yeah.
But that would obviously be one of the things that would be on my radar screen.
I got
you. There are other things that could be there also.
How does the beginning of medical marijuana play into all agencies? And I know some people get tired of hearing about this, but I'm sorry, it's a big part of what's going to happen in our state. In your particular agency or office, as far as chairman of the Mississippi Workers' Compensation, Boy, does it really hit home. We'll talk to you about that when we come back right after this. Mark Formby, chairman of Mississippi Workers' Compensation. It's going to be very, very interesting as far as how your agency deals with this. So if there's no way for you to prepare for it unless you know what the guidelines are.
That would be correct. I mean, because not only do we deal – I mean, it triangulates. You know, you have the law enforcement that deals with workers' comp cases, not law enforcement, but the system. Then we have a fee schedule where we decide what we will pay and how much we will pay for all types of medical needs, and then the employee themselves who are living in a state where the law says that if you have drugs in your system that are illegal or legal drugs that are used illegally, then your case flips. Now you've got to prove that those drugs or alcohol were not the cause of your accident. So it's kind of a strange twist. So if you have the card and you now can use marijuana for your arthritis, and if it's supposedly a low enough grade that you can still work, you know, because euphorics, you typically can't work on opiates and euphorics. So now you're at work, you trip and fall over something, and you get drug tested, and you've got THC in your system, and you whip out the card. Well, now you've got a legal drug, supposedly. It still gets federal law, yet you're in a state that says that if that is in your system at the time of the injury, you now have to prove that it didn't cause the trip, and that's a hard stump to jump.
Then, I would imagine that you also have the fact that what were the laws of the company, the rules of the company itself? Did they hire you knowing you had that in the card?
Correct. Which would rule out everybody that's working today, because today nobody was hired that way. So if we passed it tomorrow, that would you're right. That would be a whole other issue.
Well, and also grandfathered in when you come in and you've been working at a company for 15 years or 10 years or whatever it happens to be. Do you have to go up to the human resources and say, all right, officially I do have a medical marijuana card now.
Right.
And then if something happens and somebody says, look, well, we're going to move you off of this to another department, and then there's a lawsuit.
Well, there absolutely would be, because accommodation is becomes a legal word in the workers' comp system. So if you are accommodating someone to keep them at work in a place that you normally wouldn't put them, that in itself is cause for concern.
It's going to be an amazing time, and I say that from the perspective of a talk show host, not so much as an employer, because they don't know what to do. It's just going to be. Thank goodness we're not doing it immediately, because we're just trying to get the employees back to work now.
Well, and the big issue in all of this is, you know, forget marijuana, forget the fact that that is the issue of the day. Mm-hmm. The real issue of the day where I'm concerned is safety in the workplace. So if you are taking Dramamine and getting on a forklift, you have just crossed a line. And not because you could hurt yourself. You know, a forklift runs over other people. If you're shooting a nail gun and you chewed your THC gummy at lunch for your arthritis, if it compromises you in any way, you now have something in your hand carrying a hammer at the top of a scaffold. Yeah. You know, you just drop the hammer. Well, guess who doesn't get tested? The person who drops the hammer doesn't get tested. The person that gets hit with the hammer gets tested, and he was just down two scaffolds down working.
I'm thinking this is going to really complicate your life, as well as a lot of the other agencies. Let's talk about the family, because a lot of people don't know this, but when you had regular meetings and visits here, we talked about the kids. How they're doing, first of all?
They are doing well. I just got a text from Rebecca. This is, Dad, what radio station are you on?
Just tell all of them.
That's right, all of them. They're good. You know, they're great kids, and they're you know, I'm an old daddy. I'll be 65 this year. They'll be 15 and 14 this year.
Jeez.
So they're growing up quickly. You've watched that happen.
Yes. Adopted.
They're adopted babies, and they know that. So. They are in so many ways they're just typical children. Now, the complicating factor is that Eli has 6 to 12 grand mal seizures a week, dozens of petit mal seizures, little flicker seizures.
Still does?
Oh, still does every week. And he's on three or four medications. Three right now. We're starting Depakote again. So, but that also complicates any family that has a special needs child understands that it becomes a bigger issue than just that child. You know, he's got a sister that's 14 months older than him. He has intellectual deficits besides his seizure issues, and he's fun and he's bright and he's got a good memory and remembers things. He doesn't communicate real well, just cause, you know, he kind of Rain Man-ish, you know, if you see that movie. He asks the same questions over and over. But when you're the sister that's 14 months older than him, you know, that becomes both your life love and your life burden.
Have they ever tried marijuana?
So after the law semi-passed, you know, we passed a law that said that marijuana byproduct could be used in the state of Mississippi for epilepsy. Mm-hmm. That's the only place that it's legal. Sometime during the conference process, UMC became the sole distributor out of the UMC pharmacy. 5 years later, as far as I know, they're still not distributing. So if you have legal THC derivative medication, it has to come from somewhere out of state. So the answer is we're on it. We, about 2 years ago, we put him on Epidiolex, which is a non-THC marijuana byproduct, and is anybody that was around here in the 70s, I think, understands that drinking a beer without alcohol is different than drinking a beer with alcohol.
Does it do any good?
Marijuana, we have not seen anything. We have not seen any success.
Well, I thought it was the THC that actually was
I think that's the argument. That's what I'm saying. If you have a marijuana derivative and there is no THC, then you might as well have monkey grass. But let me say this, because I did support that bill. That's why I'm here today, is that I was supportive. Even at the time that I supported the legislation, went to the podium, spoke on behalf of it. Even at that time, I was not sure whether we were going to use it. I said this at the podium. We had neurologists even then telling us, you know, it may be effective for some people. It probably is effective for some people, but the same people seem to also get by with, you know, Valium or some other drug that we know a lot about. So we didn't jump right on to it. It passed 5 or 6 years ago. We finally, about 2 years ago, decided to try it. And in our case, in Eli's case, we noticed he's still on it, but we really have not seen any improvement whatsoever. And I don't say that to say that it doesn't work, because in epilepsy, different chemicals work for different body chemistries.
But if he had what we know is just a gummy bear now, whatever strength it is, would that be commensurate with what he's taking now, or that's different?
If he had anything that had THC in it, then it would be different than what he is taking
now. So you don't know if the THC would be something. You've done a lot of research on this.
Well,
you've talked to a lot of people.
I've talked to a lot of people. I've read a lot.
And have they tried it? Has the THC helped to rid that? Or
I hear, I don't know anybody personally who has used it that it has helped. I mean, I don't even know that they've used it. So anybody that I have, anything I know, I have read. So I certainly read that it has helped people. And then you never really know, you know, who the people are. In this issue, it's so hard to tell how much of it is being pushed by whom. You know, it's not the medical industry as much as the marijuana industry. And then the non-politicians, citizens, you know, like me and you, who are pushing it. Even the agendas are different. You have those who truly they have severe arthritis. They know this helps, and it does. I mean, I've got family members that have used it for arthritis, so they have a legitimate concern. But then you have people who really want recreational marijuana, and so they're up in the middle of the medical marijuana debate because they see that as a path to. Yeah.